Today's speaker really needs no introduction, which is why I was going to introduce him as Wolfgang Puck of the airport restaurant and kiosk fame. But then I realized that some of the younger folks might not really be familiar with the groundbreaking breadth and creativity of your work, Wolfgang. And B, this is really why the Vamos board doesn't let me introduce very many speakers. I decided against that joke. In any event, our speaker today is Wolfgang Ketterle from MIT. He received his diploma from TU Munich in 1982 and his PhD from LMU Munich, MPQ Garking, in 1986 under the supervision of Professor Herbert Walther. From there, he worked as a research scientist in Heidelberg at MIT before becoming professor at MIT in 1993. In 1995, he and his group achieved one of the very first atomic Bose-Einstein condensates in a gas of cesium atoms. And indeed, the rest is history. But because it's such cool history, let me add a little bit more. These Bose-Einstein condensates are really a brand new phase of matter and provided a really fertile playground for exploring all kinds of models of condensed matter physics that had really only existed in the imaginations of theorists up to that point. So he studied everything from the origins of superfluidity to vortex formation, and even pairing and Bose condensation of molecules of fermionic atoms. He then added optical lattices to the story and continued to lead the charge studying strongly interacting physics of things like mod insulators and quantum magnets. As well as recent studies of uncharged particles in synthetic gauge fields and much more. Wolfgang is the recipient of too many prizes to list within the next hour. But I should mention he received the Nobel Prize in 2001 for his contribution to Bose condensation. He's both a founder and intellectual leader of modern quantum science with ultra-cold atoms, and we're very pleased to have you, Wolfgang, to give the Vamos seminar today.
Okay, good afternoon. Thanks, John, for the introduction. I have to say I'm a little bit nervous to give this talk because due to the pandemic, the number of talks I've given in the last year is at an all-time record low. It was just, I wasn't really motivated to give online talks, but this is our new world. And I think Vamos is really the best seminar to connect our community. So therefore, I think it's a special honor and challenge for me to talk now to the best conference or the best seminar we can put together in our field. I should say I'm also a little bit nervous because I talk about 2/3 of my talks are about research I've never talked before. It is about spin physics in optical lattices. So the first time you prepare something, it has a little bit of an improvised character. And it's very lively, but also it's not yet perfect. So, and what I want to talk about is actually spin dynamics of ultra-cold atoms in optical lattices. It's something we have been working for a number of years. We wanted to really, you know, Bose-Einstein condensation, mod insulator is all about cooling to the ground state of motion. But now we want to unleash the spin degree of freedom, explore spin as a new degree of freedom and observe phase transitions, quantum control, do dynamics. And it seems after working on lots of problems with optical lattices and control in two of my labs, the lithium-7 lab and the rubidium lab, they both have really amazing results on spin dynamics. So that's the story I want to tell you. So it is part of quantum simulations. And quantum simulations does not mean that we want to simulate real materials. We want to implement paradigmatic, idealized Hamiltonian, which captures in great clarity important properties of materials. So we never try to do the messiness of real materials. We want to have idealized realizations of materials. And we use the tools and the precision of atomic physics to do that. And the subject today of my talk is spin physics, Heisenberg models with tunable anisotropy. So I don't think I have to explain to you why spin physics is important. It is spin physics captures the nature of magnetism. It's also important to understand many important magnetic materials.
But there's even more so. You can say spin physics captures almost all of physics. We learn so much about quantum phase transition, about quantum dynamics by studying spin systems. And spin systems are even more relevant because a lot of problems in physics or even outside physics, traveling salesman problem, can be mapped on spin Hamiltonian. So spin is an almost universal language to formulate problems. So therefore, we are interested in what are the possibilities, what are the features of spin physics? And almost everything I want to tell you today is captured by an innocently looking simple equation, the Heisenberg Hamiltonian for spins, which includes spin exchange, spin coupling between XX, YY, and ZZ spin. This is spin exchange. And we have the situation that the spin exchange does not happen via long range, it only happens for next neighbors. That's actually a feature of alkali atoms in optical lattices. The spin exchange is only with next neighbors. So pretty much everything I want to tell you is what is inside this simple equation. And I hope at the end of the talk, you are as amazed as I am, how much new physics can be explored by studying this Hamiltonian. So since this is a general atomic physics talk, let me maybe give you a 5-minute tutorial. How can it happen that alkali atoms, which have only contact interaction, how can we realize spin-spin coupling? How do two atoms know whether they should align or anti-align themselves if all they have is contact interaction? The answer is actually very simple. It's done by second order tunneling. This atom only knows what the spin state of the neighbor is by tunneling over and tunneling back. Second order tunneling or super exchange. And now I want to explain to you with a simple two-side model how the second order tunneling is actually creating magnetism, spin-spin coupling. And I also want to show you why the nature of the second order tunneling implies that bosons in general are ferromagnetic and fermions are antiferromagnetic. So all you have to understand for my explanation now is second order perturbation theory. In second order perturbation theory, when you have a ground state and you mix in an excited state, you lower the energy of the ground state by this undergraduate textbook expression. The lowering of the energy is nothing else than the matrix element squared over the energy detuning from the excited state. M square over delta E. Keep that in mind. So now I want to apply it to a double well potential, and I have two atoms in this double well potential. And they repel each other with an on-site interaction U when they are on the same side. So therefore, if I now translate to the previous formula, you should regard as the ground state. Let me just get a laser pointer. You should regard as the ground state, the situation when one atom is in each well, and the excited state is when the two atoms are on top of each other. So now we have two states separated in energy by U, the on-site interaction, and the matrix element is the tunneling between the two wells. So therefore, in second order perturbation theory, tunneling is now reducing the energy of the ground state by T square over U. T square over U. So this is now for two particles, red and blue. The question is, what happens if I take two red particles, bosons in the same state? You would say it's the same thing. Not quite. Bosons have bosonic stimulation. The tunneling is enhanced by a factor of square root 2. And therefore, the energy reduction of the ground state is minus 2 square over U. And that would mean if you now compare, let's say you have two component bosons, red and blue, it is more favorable if the bosons are surrounded by identical bosons. And that would mean the system would actually phase separate into two domains, a red domain and blue domain. So bosons want to be ferromagnetic. What about fermions? Oh, there's one important thing. This is for generic bosons. But if you look carefully, there may be a U, an interaction between atoms, which is different for up, up, down, down, and up, down. So these are games I want to play later for you. So we can actually, with the interactions, change the rule that bosons may suddenly become interferomagnetic. But this is now getting into more interesting and more subtle things. Let me first explain why fermions are antiferromagnetic. Well, if we have fermions in the same state, you would probably say tunneling is impossible. Well, tunneling is possible, but you have to go to the excited band. So therefore, your energy correction in second order is T square over the band gap, which I assume is weak, is huge. So therefore, you get hardly any lowering of the energy by tunneling. But if you have spin up and spin down fermions next to each other, the previous results applies. And you see that it is more favorable for fermions to be surrounded by opposite spins as neighbors. And this would imply interferomagnetic coupling. So I hope you have seen that how second order tunneling paired with bosonic and fermionic nature has non-trivial implication for magnetism and magnetic ordering captured here in a model with two sides. So I hope with when you understand the two sides, you can now understand, and this is a famous paper by Duan Demler-Lukin, which has close to 1,000 citations, that you can start with a standard Bose-Fermi-Hubbard model, where you have the tunneling energy, you have on-site interaction and all that, your standard bosonic Fermi-Hubbard model. And if you now do a second order perturbative expansion in tunneling, you obtain a spin Hamiltonian. And all these spin-spin couplings, the Z coupling, the XY coupling, have the character T square over U, second order perturbation theory. But as I pointed out, the U's can be U up, up, U down, down. So there is a certain richness to it. Now, spin Hamiltonians are important. And of course, they have been studied in many experiments. But you may be surprised to hear that okay, we've been surprised in experiments with cold atoms. They've also been, because of their importance, been implemented on ionic and Rydberg platforms. But I think you may be surprised to hear that until our experiments, all studies with ultra-cold atoms were done for isotropic spin coupling, where the SX, SX, SY, SY, and SZ, SZ interaction are identical. And the reason is when people did experiment with fermions, fermions are special as U2 symmetric, you always get an isotropic model. And for bosons, almost all studies were done with rubidium, and rubidium has this degeneracy of all scattering lengths are approximately equal, and that gives you an isotropic model. But if you now look at the Heisenberg-Hamiltonian, and delta is the ratio of the Z to X coupling, that means we have only explored one point on this continuum. And there are actually two very interesting points. One is the Ising model. When you go to a delta of infinite, then you have only coupling in the Z direction, JZ, JSZ, SZ. But another important point is actually delta equals zero. That means you have only coupling for spins in X and Y. The ZZ coupling is zero. This point is very special because for only this point, do you have an explicit analytical solution. You can do the famous Jordan-Wigner transformation and you transform the spin gas to a lattice Fermi gas without any interactions. So delta equals zero can actually be mapped on a system of non-interacting fermions with the Jordan-Wigner transformation. So this is one of the most paradigmatic Hamiltonian, the XX Hamiltonian for delta equals zero, but it hasn't been studied with ultra-cold atoms until now. So the ability to change the anisotropy of course comes with the presence of Feshbach resonances. In lithium 7, we have multiple Feshbach resonances, and as a function of magnetic field, we can change the anisotropy, the coupling of spins in Z and XY, and we can reach the non-interacting point, delta equals zero, the XX model. We can reach isotropy, where all couplings are the same, pretty much use now lithium 7 as a quantum simulator for rubidium, where all couplings are the same. And we can root minus one. So we have a huge range of scanning the anisotropy. So I don't know if there is a question about the basic concept and what we are doing, I would be happy to take a question. So far I laid out for you why we can implement a spin model with ultra cold atoms by the second order tunneling and why Feshbach resonances and the different U's give us now more adjustability for Heisenberg models and full access to the anisotropy.
I think maybe we can wait until the end of this section.
Okay, then let me move on and say, so there are two interesting aspects. One is to study the phase transition, change couplings and see what is the ground state. But what is equally or maybe even more important is to study dynamics. And how do you study dynamics? Well, you study dynamics by creating a non-equilibrium distribution and seeing how it relaxes. So in a nutshell, what we have created in our lithium 7 experiment is we've started with lithium in only one spin state, one hyperfine state, and then we create a pattern which looks like this. It's a stripe pattern. And then all we do is we watch how the stripes disappear and the spin population becomes homogeneous again. Now, how do we create the stripe pattern? Well, it's done in the following way. We take the atoms in one hyperfine state, rotate by 90 degrees. Now we have a superposition of up and down. And this is shown here. The spin is in the XY plane. But then when we apply a pulsed magnetic field gradient, the spins start winding in XY, but because of a magnetic field gradient, the spins at the one end of the chain wind more rapidly than at the other end of the chain. So we are creating a spiral pattern in the XY plane. And so if you want to study transverse spin relaxation, we just see how this pattern decays. And we detect the pattern by making a pi over two pulse, rotating from the XY plane back to Z and taking a phase contrast image of the stripes and of the contrast. But we can also, right after preparation, rotate the spins and create a spin helix in population, which involves Z, and then we just image it. So we always take the image in the population basis, but we can study the spin dynamics either when spins are transverse or when spins are longitudinal. And let me just say, by looking at the relaxation of the different helices, one is a population helix, and we measure what in NMR language is a T1 time, whereas for transverse magnetization, we are sensitive to dephasing, and this is T2. So my talk will actually naturally fall into two parts. I will first talk about longitudinal spin, which is conserved and therefore can only be transported away. And then I will talk about transverse spin, for which we find additional dephasing mechanisms. So in essence, what we are doing is we are creating those stripes. They have a certain contrast. And all I will tell you in the next 25 minutes is I will tell you, we look at the contrast as a function of time for different lattice states, for different wave vectors or wavelengths of the helix. We change the magnetic field and through Feshbach resonances, we change the anisotropy of the Heisenberg model. And we look at transverse spin and longitudinal spin. So all we do is the same thing again. We create contrast, shown here. And then as a function of time, the contrast goes away and this pattern which we have imprinted is sort of randomized again. But we just look at it as a function of many, many parameters. And I hope you will be as amazed as I am. I didn't realize what we are getting into it. What we get out of this decay is ballistic transport, diffusive transport, superdiffusion, subdiffusion. And eventually when we look at transverse spin, we see the dynamics of holes. We see effective magnetic fields. We see phenomena which is enormously rich. So just looking at the contrast decaying a whole new world of physics opens up for you. So let's right jump into in. This is the special point, the XX model, which maps to non-interacting fermions. And you see that in natural units in super exchange times, how the contrast decays. But it doesn't quite decay. You see the wiggles, you see an oscillation. And now we can use different wavelengths, different pitches of the spin helix and study things here for different wavelengths. And you see that the oscillation frequency, or the, you see that the, this is time, so the temporal frequency of this oscillation increases linearly with wavelengths. So if you measure a frequency versus wavelengths or wave vector, that's a dispersion relation. So we measure here a dispersion relation, and this dispersion relation is linear, and the slope is what is actually the Fermi velocity of the free fermions after the Jordan-Wigner transformation from the XX model to free fermions, to lattice fermions, non-interacting fermions. So what actually happens is you would actually expect the dispersion relation, if you had small perturbations around the Fermi surface, around equilibrium, you would expect the Fermi velocity. So we observe something, we are far away from equilibrium, but still, as you would expect for non-interacting system, the dispersion relation even far away from equilibrium is very similar to the dispersion relation close to equilibrium, close to the ground state. Okay, so I focused on the oscillations, but now let's focus on the overall decay. And if you look here for the maximally anisotropic model, the XX model, you observe that the longer the wavelengths, the longer is the decay time. But you can even eyeball it from the figure and say, when we double the wavelengths, the decay time doubles. And this is the physics of ballistic spin transport. If you transport something ballistically, it takes twice the time to cover twice the distance. But if we now tune to the other special point, the isotropy of the spin model, where XX, YY, and ZZ spin couplings are the same, you see a much more dramatic dependence on wavelengths. And it is actually approximately quadratic. If something takes four times the time for twice the distance, that's the physics of diffusion and the random walk. So we realize here two very different regimes. And indeed, I mean, the quality of the data is amazing. When we replot the time here, we scale linearly for the distance, and here we scale quadratically for the distance or for the wavelengths, we find a full collapse. So in other words, I've shown you with this concrete example, how do we measure the exponent of transport, namely how the time for transport depends on the distance. And I've shown you the two examples for zero anisotropy of ballistic transport. And I've shown you the other example for isotropy of diffusive transport. And it was somewhat unexpected when we mapped things out and found that the exponent was actually smoothly changing. There is subdiffusive regime, there's a superdiffusive regime. And when we go to negative anisotropy, we even have a bimodality in transport with a ballistic component and a diffusive component. So this is really currently a challenge for many body theory to understand it. We teamed up with Wen Wei Ho and Eugene Demler from Harvard, and they did numerical calculations shown in blue, which by and large capture what we have observed. Now, this transition from ballistic to diffusive is actually very special, and there are several recent papers which have debated how does this transition take place. And what we have observed was more, this is now theory, a smooth transition, whereas the prediction from near equilibrium theory was it should be ballistic, 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 and then jump to diffusive. So there is still things to be sorted out. I don't think I have the time to explain our calculations here, but they actually show that the power law behavior of the transport will actually change when we go from reasonably long wavelengths to the continuum limit, where everything happens on a scale which is huge compared to the lattice spacing. And so it seems that the continuum limit is only reached very late, and this is actually changing the power law of the transport. Okay, so this is what I wanted to talk about: longitudinal spin. Populations in spin up and spin down are conserved. Therefore, a stripe pattern in spin up, spin down can only disappear by transport. And we have seen that the time of relaxation is the longer the distance the stripe pattern is. But we have also seen that there are huge differences in the nature of the transport, with ballistic and diffusive as extreme examples. That could be a break point to take questions.
This is a great spot to take questions. Thank you, Wolfgang. We have an anonymous question, which is magnetic field variations will modulate the interaction parameters. The first half is, what are the challenges associated with stabilizing and homogenizing the field? And the second part is, are there interesting things to see with spatially modulated fields, for example, from vector Stark shift or something?
Really, these are all good questions. The field stability, well, the Feshbach resonances are 1,000 Gauss, and we usually run sophisticated magnetic field stabilities at the 10 to the minus 5 level. Unless we want to exactly pinpoint delta equals zero to high precision, the magnetic field stability is not extremely challenging because the Feshbach resonances are rather broad. In principle, one could play with vector AC Stark shift, but the vector AC Stark shift would just allow us to create, maybe apply, magnetic fields which are not subject to Maxwell's equation for magnetostatic fields.
I think
haven't considered that, because in lithium, if you want a vector AC Stark shift, you have to tune close to the D1 and D2 line, and you would have light scattering. So actually, in rubidium, I will not talk about it, but we use the vector Stark shift to do spin physics. This is work which is currently in progress, and I don't want to talk about the results yet. But for lithium, the vector AC Stark shift is not available because of the small D1, D2 line splitting.
Awesome, thank you. Okay, Bill Phillips asks, making stripes where the period of the stripes matches the period of the lattice requires an extra level of control. Is this a problem?
No, it's not. And actually, where is it? We actually are interested in the physics where the pattern is longer than the lattice constant. And so we want to study that, which is more continuous model. Actually, at some point, sometimes we would have loved to put a pattern on the, on the scale of A, the lattice constant, but unfortunately, we didn't have an imaging system to read out those patterns. So pretty much when we went to 5 lattice constant, this was the shortest period for which we still had contrast. So if you, probably the physics, the interesting physics is more in the long wavelengths part. That's where kind of most theorists would work, in the continuum limit. But I think it would also be interesting to go the shortest limit. For that, you would probably need a quantum microscope to read out, the pattern with single site resolution.
Thank you. Okay, so we have a couple more questions. Someone named Norm Yao asked, for diffusive systems, one might expect the diffusion coefficient to change as a function of temperature. Do you think it might be possible to experimentally explore this?
Well, we've done that, but what would happen is, as a function of temperature in a mod insulator, as a function of temperature, you would actually increase the number of holes in the system. And we have actually artificially heated up the system and studied transport times how did things change as a function of whole concentration or as a function of temperature. So this can be done in a rather narrow temperature regime, because if the temperature is too high and we have more than 20% wholes, that's quite a change in the system, and I'm not sure how far we can push it.
Okay. Another one, Hilary Hurst asks, is there any possibility of simulating systems with canted spin interactions like the Zyloshinsky-Moria interaction?
Yes, there are more opportunities. In the last part of my talk, I want to talk about a spin-spin Hamiltonian, which has a special anisotropy, which is a single ion anisotropy. And I think the other interaction, I don't know how to do it, but if you probably think hard enough, you always find a way to do it with cold atoms. But I will talk one about these other famous interactions later on, which is called the single ion anisotropy.
Okay, one more from Bill Phillips. He says, while the experiments show this nice transition from ballistic to diffusive transport, it looked as if the theory shows a superballistic regime, which seems quite odd. What gives?
Yes, we were really surprised. And actually, we think this is a wonderful combination of a theoretical state-of-the-art numerical calculation, experimental quantum simulation, and actually in the interplay with the theory, we've actually sorted out some artifacts in the theory. The theory did not average over random chain lengths, which turned out to be an important effect. And vice versa, we learned certain things from the theory, which we hadn't considered in the experiment. But let me just point out here that this super ballistic regime is actually something which we don't see in the experiment, where we do maybe average over a little bit more parameters than the theory, but it's also shown that this power law in the super ballistic regime, it's shown here, it's shown in this region of the theory, it actually disappears when you go to super long wavelengths. So what is really super ballistic versus ballistic, that remains to be sorted out. It seems to be related to the fact that already, even at wavelengths much longer than the lattice spacing, the granularity of the lattice is still affecting the spin transport.
Thank you. All right. So I think we'll let you continue.
So let's now go to transverse spin dynamics. So far we looked at the transport of spin up and spin down, but now we have a transverse spin helix. And as you know from NMR experiment, a transverse magnetization could in principle just disappear when you have dephasing. You don't need population, you need relaxation, you just need dephasing. And so therefore, the physics, which is now revealed by transverse spin dynamics, is actually even richer than what I told you just about the longitudinal dynamics. But let me just start with sort of a teaser. We always say we want to do quantum simulation, and the question is, what is really quantum here? So let's assume we have an XX model, where we have completely degenerate interaction in X and Y. And let's just assume, it doesn't matter what the sign is, let's assume we are ferromagnetic. If we now put a magnetization into the XY plane, what would happen? Well, the ground state, the classical ground state, is all the magnetization points in X, but it can point in any angle in the XY plane. So we have many degenerate states, but a magnetization which points in the XY plane would classically be completely stable. Well, now we put in an XY spiral, we put a magnetization into the XY plane. And I mean, just look, boom. It decays in single super exchange times. So one spin exchange time is enough to completely destroy the magnetization. So what we see here is, we see a dramatic effect of quantum fluctuations. So what happens is, when you look at classical spins, they obey the Landau-Lifshitz equation. And actually you can analytically show that a transverse spin helix, any pattern in the XY plane, is absolutely stable classically, even for arbitrary anisotropy and for arbitrary wave vector. So therefore, when we study the decay of a transverse spin helix, we are only looking at quantum fluctuations. There is no classical decay. And now, that's actually interesting. We were able to pull it off only a few months after we had taken the data. By a more careful analysis, we observed that this fast decay of the transverse magnetization is actually a little bit slower for shorter wavelengths. Here I plot the decay time versus wavelengths. So there is, it decays rapidly, but there is a Q dependence, which nobody has thought of. But together with Wen Wei Ho at Harvard, we looked now at the fluctuations around the classical solution and looked and treated them as quantum fluctuations. And those quantum fluctuations have a dispersion relation, which we could analytically derive. And this dispersion relation, it is actually surprising. Everything is faster for smaller wave vectors. So it's just the opposite of transport. The longer the distance is, the faster things decay. But what we observe here experimentally and predicted theoretically is just a manifestation of the dispersion relation of the relevant quantum fluctuations. Okay. Now, the next natural thing is we go to isotropy. And what do you expect? Well, if the spin couplings are isotropic, as studied in rubidium, a transverse spiral and a longitudinal spiral should decay in the same way because transverse and longitudinal are identical. But what we have observed here is a dramatic difference. The longitudinal spin decays by ballistic spin transport, as we've discussed before, whereas the transverse spin decays much, much more rapidly. And also when we apply a spin echo, you flip the spin in the middle of the evolution time, then if you have an inhomogeneous field or so, the spin goes backwards and you get an echo effect. You can take out some of the inhomogeneous broadening with the spin echo. Sorry, if you've never heard about a spin echo, I didn't explain it to you, but I think I reminded many people what it is. You can get rid of some of inhomogeneous decay that we have maybe different magnetic fields for different chains. And as a result, with an echo, we see a longer lifetime, a longer decay time. So what is going on here? How can an isotropic Hamiltonian make a difference between longitudinal and transverse spin? Well, you have to look really carefully when you start with the Bose-Hubbard model and derive the spin model. There is an extra term, which is an effective magnetic field. It's not an external magnetic field. It's an effective magnetic field, which comes from super exchange. So if spin up and spin down scattering lengths are different, you may still get a completely isotropic spin coupling. But then you have this extra super exchanged tunneling induced effective magnetic field. Now, okay, if it's a constant magnetic field, you can just go into a rotating frame and it disappears. And this is why nobody in the whole field and none of the theorists has ever paid attention to it. They just say, this is a constant which can be rotated away. But if we have Gaussian lattice beams, which everybody has, the Gaussian beams have a curvature that causes also a curvature of the tunneling matrix element, and therefore this magnetic field is slightly inhomogeneous. So therefore, this explains why we can get rid of some inhomogeneity with a spin echo. But now things are even wilder. When we looked at the contrast decay, we saw a little bit of oscillation. We first thought it's garbage. But then we took a section of our image and analyzed it for contrast, which was more the outer part of the cloud. And in the outer part of the cloud, we catch the signal more from isolated atoms, which surround the mod insulator. And you see how these oscillations become bigger and bigger. So what happened is, in the mod plateau, we have this super exchanged magnetic, effective magnetic field, which I described, but for isolated atoms far outside, they don't have a partner to do super exchange, their effective magnetic field is zero. So therefore, this speed node and this oscillation frequency is a direct measure, an absolute measure for the super exchange induced effective magnetic field. And within a few percent, the beat frequency which we observed coincides with the prediction based on the known scattering length of the system. You also realize when we do a spin echo, all of that goes away because a spin echo is completely eliminating any static inhomogeneity in your system. Okay, let me say where I am. We have seen that the isotropic spin model is not isotropic. There's a symmetry breaking term in this super exchanged induced effective magnetic field, which to the best of my knowledge, nobody in the field has captured. And we would say, okay, well, that just gives rise to an inhomogeneity and it's nice to see that. We can even, you know, take it to the next level if we put in deliberately not just the curvature of the lattice, but the gradient of the lattice. A gradient of the lattice creates a gradient of the effective magnetic field. And the effective magnetic field makes this helix pattern to spiral. But if the helix pattern in part of the cloud spirals faster because of the higher effective magnetic field than in another part of the cloud, that means that, you know, here are the faster spirals and here are the slower spirals, that things get tilted. So we see that as a function of time, the effective magnetic field causes a tilt of the pattern, which is linear in time. But if we run an echo pulse in the middle, you see how the tilt is going backward. You see how the echo pulse eliminates the inhomogeneous effective magnetic field. Okay, but you would say, well, these are all, you know, if you had an infinitely large laser beam and could make a homogeneous lattice, the effect would disappear. But this is not true. What we also realized is that you always have an inhomogeneous effective magnetic field at the ends of the chain. Because at the end of the chain, the atom has only one partner to super exchange with and not two. And this means when you do the math that the effective magnetic field at the ends of the chain has only half the value. So therefore, even homogeneous lattice sets with finite chains means there is a dephasing mechanism which causes the XY spiral to dephase. It starts sort of at the ends of the chain and then it propagates into the whole chain and causes dephasing. We have shown that explicitly in calculations how this effect happens. And finally, there is a third effect. And I really have to sort of, you should look at this figure. I can tell you a story about it. And that's the following. I told you that the echo is actually with a spin echo eliminating inhomogeneous decay. But now we had those curves where if you look at the arrow, the echo thing in the decay, it has this extra blip. So for certain observation times, there is an extra reduction in echo, in the echo signal, but not when we don't do the echo. I mean, I've looked at the data and I admit when I talk to Nikki about the data, I said, Nikki, that's just a glitch. Maybe at t equals zero, there is some, you know, some glitch in a function generator or so, but he looked at all the data. We never saw it other than in the echo signal. And then we took it seriously and we realized it always happens when the time involved is about a tunneling time. We have only very sparse data because we never looked at the short time. We discovered that only months after we took the data. And the only explanation is now the following. We have holes. The holes are mobile. And in a lattice, a single particle or a single hole undergoes a quantum random walk, as Markus Greiner and others have beautifully seen on a microscope. And this quantum random walk is described by Bessel functions. And this Bessel function has oscillations at a characteristic frequency and a characteristic period, which is 1/ the tunneling time. So the holes create fluctuations of an effective magnetic field, which would average out. But if you observe over a hold time, which is one period of this fluctuating effective field, and you do an echo pulse in between, you rectify the fluctuation and you get a big effect. So therefore, what we are seeing here is the effect of mobile holes. And we could probably measure, if we would look into hole concentration, we could even map out details of hole dynamics by just looking at spin relaxation. So therefore, we have now found a third mechanism where how the transverse magnetic field, how the effective magnetic field, the super exchange induced effective magnetic field can cause a decay. And this is because this extra effective magnetic field term connects, it makes the holes magnetic, because a hole is like the end of the chain, it causes a reduction of the effective magnetic field, but if the hole moves, it becomes a fluctuating effective magnetic field. And this is what just came up in the data. It's actually a new coupling mechanism between holes and magnons. So it's actually something which would connect the spin sector with the charge sector. Actually, I get very excited about spin relaxation. And I want to point out that the very first paper I've ever written, this is my theoretical master thesis, was actually on nuclear spin relaxation. And I used nuclear spin relaxation theoretically to figure out what can we learn about the dynamics of electrons. And it's just amazing if you sort of back 35 years or later, you come back to something you did, and now I use spin relaxation to study the dynamics of mobile holes. I think there would be time for a few questions, but I can also maybe just as a transition to questions, show you a little bit our lab. Is that okay? Sure, let me show you 3 minutes the lab and then I take questions. So I've talked so far, I should have gone here. So let me take you to the lithium lab. So this is where I just showed you the experiments done on lithium 7. And it shows Ivana, it shows Nikki and Jesse. This is actually something cool here, which we needed for the lithium experiment. It's a fiber coupler. And for one polarization, we use one telescope. For the other polarization, we use a second telescope, so we can make 6 laser beams, and they have different sizes for the magneto-optic trap and for the dark state molasses. Here where the coils, the compensation coils are wound, there's a bucket, and it is right here in the center that we have the cold atoms, and you see kind of all the lugs and the thick cables for the power supply. So this is the lithium 7 experiment. And after the questions, I hope I have 10 minutes left to talk about experiments in my rubidium lab. So therefore,
I think we should just move ahead to the rubidium lab experiments and then we can combine questions.
So therefore, let me now take you to the rubidium lab. And in the rubidium lab, you see sort of again, a nice sort of messy cold atom lab. You see Wu Chang, who is a senior graduate student and has major responsibility for the results I'm going to show. But you also see sort of some crazy things. A long time ago, we decided to have a Zeeman's law, which goes up to the ceiling to give us extra space. And we needed the extra space because we are transporting the atoms. We are transporting the atoms from a BEC chamber to an extra chamber, which is here where my cursor is. This is where we make the optical lattice and observe it. And we transport the atoms over, and the atoms are transported over by focusing an IR beam with this lens. We make a dipole trap. And here you see a huge translation stage. With the translation stage, this lens is moved by 30 centimeters, and the atoms are pushed by 30 centimeters into the place where the experiment is done. Okay, so this is now the transition from the lithium lab to the rubidium lab. So to make the connection, yep, I've told you this was the story about lithium 7, that anisotropy matters. But you can have different anisotropies, not just in the spin coupling. You can have also a term which is SZ squared. And because it is the Z component, it creates an anisotropy between longitudinal and XY plane. And this anisotropy is called the single ion anisotropy. It plays important roles for the Haldane phase. It is important for magnetic properties of many materials, because this is what is caused when a crystal field breaks the degeneracy of d orbitals, and d orbitals play a major role in magnetism of materials. But it is also the SZ square operator for many of you. It's a squeezing operator which creates interesting physics. So this anisotropy cannot be created by just having spin with one atom per side. This anisotropy requires side occupation, a mod insulator with two or more atoms per side. And so what happens now is, if you have two atoms per side, you can have blue-blue, blue-red, and red-red. And in spin notation, this means it's a spin one system with spin z plus one, minus one, and zero. And now if the interactions between AABB and UAB is different, and you subtract the constant chemical potential, you can map this system to such a system where you have an extra energy plus D for red, red, and blue, blue, and energy zero for red, blue. And so with this definition of the single ion anisotropy parameter D, you have this energy, which is D times SC squared. So by using, again, atomic interactions AABB and AB, we can now introduce in an N equals 2 mod insulator a spin 1 model with this special anisotropy. Well, if you had asked me a year ago, I would have said, but not in rubidium. Rubidium has all the scattering lengths equal to within 1%. But what happens is, what matters is not delta U over U. What matters in the spin Hamiltonian is the ratio of D to super exchange. And super exchange is much, much smaller than U. It is actually tunable by making the lattice deeper and deeper. So therefore, we have a huge tunability of our Heisenberg model, because we can tune the ratio D over J from being much smaller than one to being much larger than one. The question is, how do we change the sign? Well, we realized when you look at different hyperfine states, 1, 1, 1, minus 1, and 1, 0, you actually find a combination where D is positive and one where D is negative. So now we have full axis. So how do we observe the anisotropy? Well, an important quantity is the longitudinal spin alignment. It says, is the spin more pointing in the Z direction or more in the XY? So this parameter spin alignment A is defined in such a way that it is zero for random spin distribution. So how do you measure A? Well, it's rather straightforward. If we measure the fraction of doublons with SZ equals zero, or the probability that a doublon is red-blue, this fraction gives us exactly A. I mean, if the fraction is one-third, this is just randomness. All spins are one-third, one-third, one-third. But if we have an excess of red and blue of those paired doublons, we have a spin alignment. So all we have to measure is what fraction of the doublons is red-blue. And the simple message is we simply measure that by tuning to a Feshbach resonance, which creates molecules out of the red and blue. They disappear, and then we just measure how many atoms are missing after we have tuned to the Feshbach resonance. In practice, it's more complicated because there is no red-blue resonance. We have to use a few microwave pulses and go to a suitable resonance. We also have to normalize because we also have singlons in the system. But in principle, this is what we are doing. We can measure the fraction of paired doublons. And now what we do is the following. We prepare an N equals 2 mod insulator. We rotate into a superposition state where the alignment is exactly 0.5. And then we allow the anisotropic model to take over and we look the spin dynamics. And after a certain hold time, we measure the doublon fraction. And what we measure is quite interesting. You would expect in a thermal relaxation, you start at 0.5 and it just decays to zero. But what we observe is we observe coherent oscillation because of coherent spin dynamics. And we see that if D is positive, we see an overshoot. If D is negative, we see an undershoot. But we only see a sizable overshoot or sizable undershoot at very specific lattice states. So there is a resonant effect. We only see the coherent oscillation when we have tuned the two terms in the Hamiltonian, the single ion anisotropy, to be comparable to J. So this is a non-trivial effect of the dynamics of this anisotropic Hamiltonian. And we could actually understand that qualitatively by looking at a two-side model. This is a nine-dimensional Hilbert space, but we figured out that in this nine-dimensional Hilbert space, it is a two-dimensional subspace which is responsible for the oscillation. And eventually we could understand semi and have almost quantitative agreement with our result that this oscillation is the precession on a weird Bloch sphere, which has certain weird states as the North Pole and the South Pole. Anyway, I think I've used up my time. I hope I was able to show you that spin physics is interesting and that with cold atoms, we have only explored a very small fraction of the interesting physics we can do with spins. We have a long list of things we want to do in the near future. But I think let me just come to the credits. Here are the name of the people who do it. Actually, we are looking for a postdoc now in both of those experiments. So feel free to send me a message if you're interested. And today I was reporting on results of the rubidium lab and the lithium lab. And here you see the people who have done the work. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for a wonderful talk, Wolfgang. We have quite a number of questions, and we're going to get to a couple of them. Just as a reminder to everyone, there's going to be an after event where you can talk to Wolfgang, and it'll be posted to the Zoom shortly. So if your question doesn't get asked, you can ask him directly there. So Vaibhav Sharma writes, why is the relaxation behavior so different, super diffusive versus super ballistic? For anisotropy tending to positive infinity versus negative infinity?
It's a really good question. I wish we would understand it. I think this came unexpected. I talked to some of the leading theorists, some of which are in the audience, and I don't think they expected that. And especially the fact that What came completely unexpected for us is the fact that on the positive anisotropy side, things just can be just rescaled. When we scale time with the power law, all the data collapse for the different Q vectors. So we clearly see power law transport. But on the negative side, we actually see two different power laws, one at early times and one at late times. All I can say is we had Wen Wei Ho at Harvard Harvard and Stanford, he did numerical calculations and the blue data shows that he could reproduce it. So it seems not an artifact of the experiment, it's captured by the Hamiltonian, but I think we are lacking the deeper insight why this is happening. So here's a challenge
for low dimensional degree of freedom model to understand it. Okay, next question. Bill Phillips asked, have I correctly understood that even with echo, you have this faster decay due to a combination of holes and end effects? Should this all go away in a large sample with lower charge temperature, no holes?
Okay, if you go to the thermodynamic limit of infinitely long chain, the end effects will go away. But we saw that they have a strong effect on the typical chain lengths we realize in our experiments. So therefore, in other words, you cannot really talk about quantum simulations, at least experimental quantum simulation, without addressing the end effects. But therefore we do feel, yes, the end effect is important, the mobile holes are important, but in the limit of infinitely long chains and in the limit of zero temperature, you could avoid both.
So maybe I can give what I think is maybe a clarification there. It seems like if the time it takes the stuff on the ends to make it into the chain is short compared to the other decay mechanisms, or is long compared to the other decay mechanisms, you wouldn't see that, right? Or is the point that essentially the chain length is fairly small compared to the system size right now? And so
this is a little bit subtle. We did spatially resolved simulations, and you see that the phase pattern of the stripes is kind of tilting away and distorting, and it starts from the end. So now when you say it depends on time, it also depends what do you fit. If you would fit the global contrast, you would see an immediate decay of the contrast because it decays in part of the cloud. If you could pick out the central part of the chain, of course, it takes a sort of Robinson leap bound. It takes a certain time for the perturbation of the end to propagate to the center. So now we're really talking about the question is, what do you call the observable? Do you look at global contrast? Do you look at local contrast? So things becomes a little bit rich. But for the time scale of our experiment and typically, you know, chain lengths between 10 and 20, those things contributed to a homogeneous decay of the overall contrast.
Thank you. Okay, so our last question is again from this Nor Miao character. He asked, is it possible to also measure the transport of energy in the spin model? Even in the regime where spin transport is diffusive, energy transport is expected to be ballistic, which would be very cool to see.
I haven't thought about it. How would you measure energy transport?
Maybe heat a region and measure temperature locally.
Heat the region and see how temperature, how heat conduction goes through the spin system. Sounds challenging, but not impossible.
Thank you. Okay, so thank you again, Wolfgang, for a really wonderful talk. Let me share my screen for a moment here. And can everyone see this? Good. Should we turn on subtitles? Okay, subtitles. And of course it's the wrong screen. But you can all see it. Great. I don't know what's going on here. The next talk for Vamos is next Friday, the 26th. And the speaker will be Nurgis Malavala from MIT, presumably talking about squeezed light in LIGO. And our sister seminar series, the Quantum Science Seminar, will have a talk by Ed Narovicius from Weizmann. And that'll be on Thursday at 5 p.m. CET. So on that note, thank you all for attending. And I just wanted to remind everyone that there is a link posted in the chat for the post-seminar discussion. There were a tremendous number of questions that we didn't have time to pose to Wolfgang, but you should definitely not be shy. Wolfgang is wonderful, and he'll be happy to chat with you afterwards, and you can ask him directly. So thank you, everyone, for attending.
Wolfgang, thanks so much. That was a great talk.
Yeah, it was really
welcome.
Wonderful. Thanks.